your program. I'm happy that tonight with us we have four panelists for the conference titled Radical Pedagogy and Autonomous Research on Libraries, with lectures and presentations by Bernhard Rüdiger, Esther Leslie, Daniel Consentino, and Besa Luzha. You have their bios in the programs here in the office. The conference briefly aims to provide a critical view and discuss positions, experiences, and practices in the higher education and the education systems in France, UK, US, and Kosovo. All these individuals are in one way or involved with institutions, systems, it's, let's say, quite a unique experience to have them share this experience from these different geographies in many ways, but which I find also interconnected with their influences in the given context. So thank you again for being here with us. I give the floor initially to Bernhard Rüdiger. Just briefly, Bernhard leads a research-based unit at Ensba in Lyon, the National School for the Arts in Lyon. And the performance that we saw last night is by one of the members of the research unit. And it was for us important to stage the performance to see how that unit is materialized, basically, through the practice of an artist. And I'm looking forward to hear more about research units and their work in general. Thank you so much, Bernhard.
Thank you, Albert.
Just need to forget to mention, Ensba is also a partner institution for some sort of school since a few years now. And we have, we also signed an agreement for next four editions, if I'm not mistaken, of the summer school. And they provide also the accreditation for the courses organized at summer school as well.
Thank you, Albert. And thank you all for being here. I will try to explain some decisions and some the way I give some problematics to the main problem, let's say, to be an artist in the time of what now needs to rise and to become what it is, and in the second point also to be in a space that is a space of research. It is more and more a space that it becomes, I would say, smaller and smaller, because it becomes bigger and bigger in number, so different factors, different approach, but the roots become more and more stronger. And this is a problem I have faced in a very way, let's say. Maybe to be more precise about from where I speak. So I'm an artist, teaching in the art school in Lyon. I'm not French. This is an important point, because when you live in another country, you have a point of view that is always a little bit standing on my side, and this can help to recognize problematics that you don't see in your own mind. I would not have seen my own life as was educated in Milan. So this is the first important point. The second point, I'm an artist, because I'm very engaged with questions of research. I've been traveling very much to defend politics of research. And one of the things that is really disturbing is when you are somewhere discussing research, somehow people tell you, so you're not a real artist. So to be clear, from the beginning, I'm a real artist, I'm a orchestra artist, but I also teach. And this is a very important political choice for me. I grew up in a country, Italy, that was very strongly neoliberal in the 80s. This term has been a very violent term. The art market and all the roots of the art market has been a real challenge in a very, very dark period, the 80s, the 90s, to be more clear. The the end of terrorist time in Italy, the accomplishment of the terrorism of mafia, and the conjunction of neoliberalism founding of new economics with the mafia activity in Italy. So that brought 94 Berlusconi to be prime minister. So this is the context in which I grew up, and that brought me to think that an artist has not to work with this kind of power. You can also use other powers, and the teaching is one of them. So it is for me a very important issue. Then to precise my condition in France, art schools in France are autonomous. It's a very important point. Since the 18th century, they were mostly founded on craftsmen's specializations in some cities. So there are a huge number of art schools, 45, with a real that brought in French history, with the reform of university after the revolution of the students in 68, to stay in autonomy, so that architecture, let's say, went over to university, but art teaching stayed autonomous. So in the 80s, with the left-wing government of Mitterrand, the work rate, a really strong ministry of culture, that was strong also before and after wartime, but it had a new term, and this new term, the ministry from which we depend is Ministry of Culture. In the situation nowadays, the Ministry of Culture went through all the forms of colonial reforms, so that we are credited with capital, but it stopped in the third level, so that we were with bachelor, master, or they did it the other way around, master, bachelor, and then the question and research. And now the government is more not so interested in the question of arts. In this moment, their aim is to transform research only in university research. In France, university is strongly autonomous after 68. That means that there is any PhD type in France, there is only doctoral. And this is a special title for French university. So if we would like to have this kind of title, we should be accredited by university. That means that as a director of research, I would have to make my habilitation through the university to be habilitated to teach my courses of art school. So this was for me always a very important political issue. And I will try to explain why this issue and where does it come from, why this autonomy seems important to me. And let's say that this brought me also this very important point, to be very active in my teaching, when I began to with this research unit, it is contemporary art and historical temporalities, I began to work with an art theoretician from Ecole des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, which is an autonomous research university in Paris, mainly on sociology, but with a very important department of theory of arts. We built this research unit together, and so I precise from the beginning, we were very, in a very direct way, working with university. If there's any problem for me to work with university, to have very strong collaborations. But for me, the question of who gives the title to whom is a question of what is a discipline of art. And this is what I will try to explain you in the example of what we did in Lyon. So we founded in Lyon the first research unit 16 years ago. And in the same year, there was another research unit, and we built a little bit together. And then the two units went really radically different way. So, Locusons decided to go to Swiss Open University, and we decided to build a kind of title that is a PhD title given from our university, from our art schools, so that now in France we have around a fifth part of six or seven art schools giving this kind of research that we built as an anonymous title given from the art schools through the Ministry of Culture. This construction of this research unit came in the art schools in the moment in which the Bologna reform brought the art schools also to redefine what they teach, how they teach, and though this work on the pedagogy brought us to understand that there was another third moment in teaching. So I think in art you have about around 10 or 15 years. Only the first 5 years are in art school, and then you are a little bit alone, somehow lost in the world, trying to reconnect and find another way of learning. So it was important for us to construct this third part, and let's say with our research unit, to be more clear in time, it was in a moment in which in art, contemporary art, the discussion about documentary film and documentary photo was very important in the end of the 90s, beginning of 2000. And I was confronted in pedagogy very often with the subject, yes, but it's reality. So I'm filming reality. Students will say, it's reality, I'm filming reality, that's reality. So the question began to say, no, it's not reality, you are cutting, filming, framing, constructing, choosing. So what it is, what is that? And all this discussion around what is reality brought us to think about a problematic that I try to resume very quickly because the research is a long process. So let's say very quickly, we work around the question that how do you connect experience and how do you look at reality? And then in these years in France, the question about the film Shoah and the film by Godard brought to a very hard discussion about can you documentate the Shoah or not. This brought us to develop, let's say, an approach on ethics. What is the representation of real and what brings ethics into it? What is the role of ethics? So that we work very much, and I personally in my own work very much on total catastrophe, on World War II, let's say, or Hiroshima bombing, and what is it a shape that can subsist and an experience of a shape in this condition of after total destruction. So the content of the research unit were all very often came from this search and brought us to develop some paradigm very linked to the experience of shock, so the non-experience, what is non-experience in an art experience, and all these kind of issues. So this is to make a very short to say where we work. But how we work is another big question. So as an artist, I'm confronted here you see, this is for my students here, you're working with Yann Mitterio, that is one of our, has been one of our researchers now, teaches with me here in Stasha, two courses on the models. You see here my workshop, and this is an installation of models, it's very often still in my workshop. I'm dealing with shapes. This is my main problem. Not that I cannot speak, or I cannot think, or I cannot produce theory, but in first place, I work with shapes. So this is an element that in an art school cannot be simply, very often in the official textbooks of the state, put by side and say, yes, okay, you work on art, so let's make theory on what you do. I don't make theory on what I do, but with. The elements I propose. And this difference, the shift, is for me a very important shift. So I do not research on art. I do practice-based research. And that is not a practice-based research in British sense. It is research that is constructed on the fact that the shape is an element of theorization. So how to get this into the process of research? When I work with research, I work with shapes. So I will be very short in this, but I will try to be more clear. When I talk about shapes, I'm using here a drawing by Oscar Schlemmer, The 20s in Germany has produced a very important theoretical approach of the experience of the shape. So maybe that the courses of Klee are more well known because he wrote them down. Schlemmer has own drawings, so he never wrote them down, but in his schematas there is a real very complex relation to thinking of the shape. So, form, I use expressive the Latin term because it contains the notions on informare, to inform something. It's not the same as if we say the shape, the outstanding contour of something. So when I say shape, I intend the fact the shape is informed. It's something that we name this object of this movie. But shape is also this, what I look at. So when I say shape, I would use the term that was used in Bauhaus, that is Gestalt. It is the body that becomes, it is the thing that becomes a body, right? The object which stays in front of me. This is the sense of Gestalt. So when we say form in terms of Gestalt, we are not only saying the object that is in form, but we are discussing the object in front and the way I look at the object. It's a little bit nearby some talked about today. So the real translation is the action of a body. So the gaze is an active gaze. And to turn back to the terms of what I think are essential characteristics, is that shape is something that is not stable. That means, if I look at an arc, the arc exists in relation to another arc. This is a question of relativity. It is relative to the context I look to, in the context in which I look. And the context is a complex issue, because it's not only the context of the room in the museum I look at it. But it's also the non-given culture, the non-outspoken culture, I bring with me when I look at the shape. So I look at the shape because I saw, I don't know, Leonardo da Vinci in my life. I saw Leonardo da Vinci, so I can never think again of a perspective in mountains or whatever without having an head Leonardo da Vinci. So that when I look at new painting, I look in relation to Leonardo da Vinci. This is a very important question in art history. As the artist sees it, the artistry is what the contemporary, in contemporary time, we reconstruct from given time. So artistry is exactly the contrary of what is in the discipline of art history, that is the result of given elements. For an artist, artistry is the shift I do in relation to things that has existed. So this is relatively conditioned, it's a condition of relativity of this discussion around what do I see, how do I see it, in relation to what I see. And this is a typical discussion in critics, in art critics, what is the shape, how is it, in relation to what it is, and this always. But there is a second element that is important, and this is the instability. Because culture changes, and I was not born in the time of Leonardo da Vinci. And if I still look at this picture and I still see something, but I certainly don't see what Leonardo da Vinci saw or his neighbor saw when he looked at the picture. So shapes are not an archaeological element you put in a museum and then it is what it is. It's something you took out of a context and then it stays only in relation to the context. It stays also in relation to the evolution of the culture. So today with our smartphones, we look at shapes certainly different than Leonardo da Vinci, because we have another relation to shapes. So instability is a very important element that makes it in art history. You can, for hundreds of years, not look at something. You don't see it. It is up in front of you. How long times we looked at Middle Age bas relief without looking at them because we are interested in Renaissance. And then in a moment there is someone who sees something in it, and again this form becomes an active form. So shapes can be deactivated by culture, but in a moment they can be reactivated. So the shapes are in a kind of form of instability. And I think it's important to understand that in art, these two elements are really important. But these two elements create a third element on which we have been discussing in the course of a few moments, that is the potentiality of something that can arise that is still not there. So when artists work with shapes, they do not only put shapes together or make a new shape, they also potentially think something that is came out of these two elements, instability and relativity. And in the discussion of this, then it opens up the potentiality of something that is different. So, what we name avant-garde, modern art, is nothing else than the potentiality of a shape that wasn't there before. So I think that when in art we discuss about shape, these elements are very important. What is the problem? The problem is that when you work in art history, you are working in a discipline that says that the shapes are given in time. So the discipline, you cannot write art history discipline, research or research PhD, if you don't know all that art history. You go to the discipline is in the university. University is the home of a collective memory, through which you go as a student for 5 years. And when you went to the PhD program, you begin to discuss some changes. This is, I think, important to understand that gestalt or shape form cannot be used this way because it is unstable, relative, and potential. So, if we do a real art-based research, we have to deal with shapes. We have to make them through shapes that have this character. So, I cannot put them in art history. I cannot put them in a discipline. You see what I mean? I cannot put them to universal knowledge in university. And this is, I think, one of the biggest problems in art research. A big problem also because the administrators and politicians we work with don't understand it. So I am old, I have white hairs, I really worked very much in politics on this. I created in France, or I participated in creating the Council of Higher Education and Research for Culture. Now I'm sitting in this, very useful, theoretically useful and in practice not useful premium. I've been engaged in the French Association of Art School to bring this to Europe, in the ELIA Association, nothing. So I'm becoming old, a little bit tired of this, but I'm convinced that the question remains a main question. We cannot adapt to this. It is not because I'm an artist and I want to do my work. It is because in art teaching, we don't teach the person to go through a discipline, but we teach a person to get his own discipline. And this is a very important thing. An artist, a well-teached artist in a good art school, learns what is his or her discipline. I'm the one who can tell you which is my discipline as an artist. And this difference is never heard and brings very important misunderstandings. So, what can we do? Because I would say for myself, there's not so much time left. And I began to think that I will never reach it. But it has been one interesting element. It is the OECD made in the 40s a Frascati manual on teaching and research. research, on innovation, let's say. The question is innovation. And as you can imagine, in 2014 or something like this, no, 2007, excuse me, I think 2007, the European Union had the idea we have to rethink this because innovation, creativity, all these fake names are really important. So they did the work, they did the job. And this was quite interesting at the end, because it says nothing. Not in the sense that it says nothing, it don't precise me. Because neoliberal ideology needs to let liberties open as possible. So from the 40s, the shift that was made from the 50s, written in the 50s, to the 2007, is that neoliberalism brings in some kind of very open definition of what is innovation and research. So it is a very interesting tool, because by not defining what it is, and letting so open as possible things, art fits into it. And this is the very first time that art fits into this kind of general definition, what is teaching, research, and all that. So it is a real, it was a real opportunity. So ELIA, the association of all the art schools and art academies, Germany, all of it, of creation in Europe, that is a typical European association, used this opportunity. Here, I show you only this aspect of Andrea Reif, which she teaches in Vienna, and she's now again president, and she was very active in this idea, and they made a kind of text out of it for the art schools. The only big problem is all is what you want, but they forgot only one thing in the text. They never speak about art. So in the whole text you can find, you can find it very easily in Elia's documents, you will not find the name artist. The artist is not existing. And the language is really awful. It's a language for European, only people that work in European community can understand what is written there. But why not? This can be a political choice to say we write for them, so let's write in the language. So I'm nothing against this. The only reason is they forgot that maybe art research could concern artists. And they looked at it only from the point of view of the institutions, of the university, and all that. So that they translated the very open approach of in a very incomprehensible language of people working for the European Union, but they forgot this only point that made it ask for the practice. So that the art research becomes an evolution of for teachers, for scholars, or whatever, but not for artists. And this is a real mistake. Okay. There was a really big opportunity that has been missed, and the only thing they do now is to take off on their site, so you find it only in the documents when you really look. But even if it was under Flemish direction at this moment, and the idea, really the idea of negotiation and to negotiate for the art school, the type of PhD, so I can understand, but the mistake, don't forget artists, is a very important mistake, because this brought very much artists to work for careers of teachers or whatever, but not for artists. And as I tried to discuss with Brandt about this, her answer was simply, yes, but don't worry, you will evaluate also. All the artists will evaluate at the end, and they will learn to write pieces. You see, so the even the ones who really were involved in this defense of the idea that research has to be open to artists, end up to explain you that you will learn to write, as if you couldn't. To say that this lapsus of forgetting artists and art schools seems to me a very important point in politics. Because the institution, and this is normal, and I saw it myself as working very much in these political institutions, after some years, you begin to use the language of these people. Because you are always discussing these people in one point, and then second, is you want to be understood. So you adapt your language. But by adapting your language, you forget out the artist of the school. And you work only for the school as institution, titles, accreditations, whatever you have to write for all that. But you forget that an artist goes for a school and makes another career. So how to build up research based, art-based research, for artists, in which the career can be the real object also of the research. So there are two points that seems positive to me. One point, and it's an important point, artists never stay long time in school. I mean this not in the career of an artist, but in the history. In this moment, in fact, we are in a very good career. All teachers have came from our schools, all artists come from our schools. There has never been, in French history, a kind of connection of this type. Art schools, let's say, in this sense, has never been so good. All artists are really involved as teacher or pupils in art. But it can stay 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, and then the artist goes. And they go somewhere else. And they will learn somewhere else if the art school is not an art school. You see, if you work on institutional level and you work only by the rules of the institution and you forget the artist, the artist also has. And this happened in really very much examples in the 20th century, 21st century in Europe. There are countries in which you have art schools, but no more artists than art schools. There are teaching systems in which you don't teach art, but you teach art of the 19th century. There are systems in which, like I think on my school in Brera, Milan, it was a very open school. Now they have classes for Chinese students because Chinese students pay 10,000 euros a year. So they have a class only for Chinese students speaking only Chinese with an assistant translator. So, they don't come to learn art, to come to have a diploma. And it works in terms of economy, it not works very well. But in terms of producing art, it's not that good. So what I mean is important to understand that when we work on our structures, as an artist or working in art school, I have also to pay attention that it's not only the structure that determines what is which are the group, but it's also the artists. So, what I to come back to my problem of shape, I think that one of the main problems, as I said, in research generally, because I'm really not saying that artists is different from other research, I say that the methodology is different. But we need to have the potentiality in the system. So we need a research based on art. So what did we do? Because I will close it down. What did we try to build? What we try to build is to include all theoretical approaches. We work pretty much with philosophers, with art theoreticians, with xenos and neologists, with cinema theorists, you can go on our website and you see all the people that come to our seminars. We have a very huge number of personalities coming and different approaches. So, work with theory does not mean, you know, does not mean that we don't confront our theory with the methodologies coming from other different domains. And even more, it is much more important that this confrontation is really built. Then there are methodologies, how do you do it? So very often we create what we name intensive seminars. We invite Michael Fried for 3 days so that he is submitted to our kind of violent situation to discuss for three days. But we also have to hear him, or we might have to look at him for 3 days. That in this kind of confrontation, the theoretical misunderstanding that is always existing between artistic approach and theoretical approach finds a kind of discursive, it is a site in which this confrontation, this non-being in the same place, but being obliged to be someone in the same place, brings really very interesting results. So, work with theory does not mean that we don't confront our theory with the methodologies coming from other different domains. And even more, it is much more important that this confrontation is really big. Then there are methodologies. How do we do it? So very often we create what we name intensive seminars. We invite Michael Fried for 3 days so that he is submitted to a kind of violent situation to discuss for three days. But we also have to hear him, or we might be free to look at him, for 3 days. That in this kind of confrontation, the theoretical misunderstanding that is always existing between artistic approach and theoretical approach finds a kind of discursive, it is a site in which this confrontation is not being in the same place, but being obliged to be somewhere in the same place, brings really very interesting results. So one strategy was never abandon theoretical confrontation. And a second approach is never abandon artistic theory. That means very often silence. I look beyond, because Jan has done his PhD, but Jan was a silent researcher. In Michalowicz, he's a very silent researcher. Both. That means, that does not mean that the PhD of Jan is based on the fact that he worked with the fact that a month can come into your work and then came into his, one of his works, and then he works with this idea that the displacing of the spaces replaced radically all problem of aesthetics. You cannot think in aesthetics if it's not for the spaces of the room. So you see, it's a really theoretical problem based on questions on perception. It's a very complex theoretical problem. But it also works very much with science, with the fact that he proposed in a discussion, I don't remember if Michael Friedman proposed, but in a discussion that came in with a philosopher we will talk in the next day, you brought a problematic that the philosopher could not think. But he had to think. I remember one discussion, to make an example, with an Italian philosopher, Montani, we were discussing about the question of ethics about Shoah. And one of our researchers, an artist, Benjamin Sehor, living now in Athens, he thought, yes, but I have a testimony, or I cannot testify, but in art, I can also love. And this is a very complex philosophical problem, because philosophers cannot think this sidestep of love. And it was a really interesting problem to open up the ethical problem of testimony to the fact that in art, you can displace it by nothing. And this opens up for us a very enormous theoretical field to think this. I'm still working on punching on the problem of Latin now, 15 years later. So what you see what I mean is this kind of confrontation of different terms with different language is for us very important too. Then maybe to be very short, because Albert didn't decide that long ago, I show you here only the picture of one exhibition. In this exhibition, it was a closed exhibition. So it's a real exhibition in the gallery of the art school. Then we closed the exhibition, no one stepped in, only the researcher. And for 2 months, we were leading an exhibition by creating an atlas. Here you see an atlas of Avivando. Here and then this is an atlas of Gerardus. So, beginning with few examples, we began to discuss all the existing articles by cutting photocopies, cutting text, put them near one another without explaining in written words what these connections are, but by constructing dialectical distance in between objects we brought together. This, at the end, will be open exhibition. But we opened the exhibition for one day. But it brought also to the way we construct a book plate and also spend the time. And this is the second chapter on shock. The chapter on shock were constructed by discussions and images. And that's another positive what we were important, is the notion of discussion. That we can say as a discussion, but we use the term of Gadamer, Husky of Gadamer, 60 terms, that is interlocution, it comes from the language. The idea that then you have two people discussing or people discussing, there is another object emerging, is there only for the moment of discussion. This has become for the group a very important tool. So that there is always a singular approach, singular words, singular ideas coming from the work of everyone of us. But there is also a tool that is the interlocution, that produces this kind of very, we saw that by producing atlases, we were producing this third object. That was not only my work, let's say, here there is some of my work, but it's not only my work. Because in the moment in which it's confronted in a discussion, it becomes the problem of another. So, some of these tools, to make an example, have become theoretical tools. So that the exam we did now, we do now, are very often constructed with two elements. One element at a time. I said to my art school, if you want me to make the research, you don't give me any time. Okay. So that researcher can stay 10 years in this section. They are a little ahead for 3 years and then they stay. So they don't have to have results or to make their PhD in 3 years. And this is a very important thing for artistic career, because if not, you cannot make this in the second. In the second element is that the defense is not built on writing, but I never succeed to have one exception, so the book not write. This is a little bit deceptive for me. They all write somehow. But the writing is only one element. So that the book we are now making with Young in the camp is based on the PhD of Young. It's discussions that Young constructed with the jury we decided 1 year before. Young began different kind of discussions that produced different kind of texts. This is one element, then there was an exhibition, then there was another work, and then Young had an oral demonstration based on the models of different things we construct. So we are trying to construct defenses that are always working with more than one element, so that it is not the written thesis, but it can be a written part, but it's confronted with another and with another, so that the interlocution has become, let's say, the way we construct the defense. And now these last years with the family work very well. We are trying also to involve the jury much before the defense, so that all this artistic field can be also understood by the jury in different ways, because very often they are philosophers or there are different fields. So, to define the jury and to discuss with the jury what it is artistic work is. We had one of gender terrorists we were working on with Jan. It was very interesting because she took, I think, Jan 3 months before she could even understand what Jan was talking about. The discussions went for 3 months before she could somehow translate in her own theoretical language what was the language of Jan. So we are trying to do this in Lyon, and we are trying to defend it politically to become a recognized PhD. So now in France it's complicated, we're trying to go to Europe, but maybe I will not have any hair at the end of this other process. Thank you very much.
We will take questions in the end, I think. Let's move to the next presentation. I hope there'll be a wrestler with us, Esther Leslie. Esther Leslie is a professor of political aesthetics at Birkbeck University of London. Her books include various studies and translations of Walter Benjamin, as well as Hollywood Flatlands, Animation, Critical Theory and the Avant-Garde, published by Verso in 2002, Synthetic Worlds, Nature, Art and Chemical Industry, published in 2005, Derelicts, Through Worms from Us, and the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you. My paper, in some ways, is quite poetic, a little bit theoretical. So I just want to preface it with some sense of the context from which this comes. So it's a context in which, if you would go and study at the Royal College of Art in London as a home student, now you will pay £15,000 a year. And as an international student, you will pay £30,000 a year. This is big money. It's expensive and it's not always good. And the people teaching you have been in battles, many of them are precarious. I do some PhD work there to get paid. It's very, very hard. So there's a strange financial imbalance. And it's also the context, and maybe this is something we talk about in discussion, this market in higher education, which exists in the UK now, is producing many closures, especially within the humanities. Humanities departments are closing or retracting, and the right wing or our government really jump on the rhetoric. So after George Floyd, Black Lives Matter, there was a language, defund the police. Now the right wing say, first it was defund the BBC, the state broadcaster, I think they're too left wing, and now it's defund the humanities. And our politicians, you know, last week, one of them who wants to take over from Boris Johnson, Rishi Sunak, said, if I become Prime Minister, I will crack down on degrees that produce low-wage graduates. So after 6 months, the university see how much the graduates earn, and they give you a rankings table. Now the irony is, you know, the lowest-paid graduates are our nurses, you know, our absolutely essential workers who were clapped during COVID. But what everybody knows Rishi Sunak means, people who study media studies, people who do art. Reality is those are probably higher earning in the end. But so it's all rhetoric, but so this is the context.
Just to explain, Sunak is in this competition between two people to become the future Prime Minister.
Because Boris Johnson was stabbed by his own party.
And he's the front runner, I think, still.
Well, no, Liz Truss is Margaret Thatcher reanimated, is probably going to be our leader. As Zizek says, like my son says to me, but who do you want? I want neither, they're both conservatives, but who is better? And I take Zizek's line, both are worse. So, and another context then is, in response to this market, there have been initiatives, Open School East in Margate, School of the Damned, which do unaccredited master's level education. So we could talk a little bit about how those are structured. But this paper comes from an opportunity I was given to write a manifesto for a radical international university. The invitation came from Jason Barker, who teaches at some university in South Korea, and he organized me, Alberto Toscano, Nina Powell, and people to make a manifesto. But what I ended up saying reflected on the situation of higher education in the United Kingdom where I teach. So in the past 10 years, there have been at least three large strikes in the higher education sector in the UK. Very boring fights over pay and conditions, cuts and downgrades, overwork, and market competition within and between universities. And at each picket line, so the line, you know, you stand in front of the university and you ask people not to cross, at each picket line, I and others have delivered short agitational talks. And what we tend to do now in the UK, that during strikes, it's very popular to have these things called teach outs. So teachers will give lectures, often quite politicised, perhaps related to their discipline, on the picket line, and we hope to gather the students. Sometimes this can become a form of appeasement. So the student who is a customer, who has paid money, is angry their classes don't happen. So maybe something about, you know, decolonizing history as a sort of open air thing. And then the students, you know, are happier, they get something. On the first picket line, I remember I spoke about Walter Benjamin's passionate words about youth and experience and how experience is used as a stick to beat young people with. And he had a radical program for educational reform in 1910 in Germany. And on the second one, I spoke through a megaphone to other people who were with me, as Paul Gilroy, Matthew Beaumont, and the students were passing, most of them were crossing the picket line. It was not at my university, we were not on strike, but it was at the university next door, University College London. And I spoke there just before that event. A friend of mine, a poet, Sean Bonney, had committed suicide in Berlin. He was 50. And I began with an extract of one of his poems, which is here. Please don't cry, time will come. Bear that in mind. Remember, don't look at me, don't cry. We are gathering the pieces. There will be no locked doors, no officials, no murders, no slayers. Sometimes we'll speak in colours, in musical notes. No passwords, no secret codes. But remember, serious, keep a pill in your mouth. Keep it there. These words there. Solitude, profit, humiliation, suicide. That's the dictionary of history. When they shoot it at us, fire back. I can't lie, things will get harder. But keep at it, despite our violence, our addictions, all this burden. And I went on to give some context to Sean Bonney as a kind of example, lesson, teaching lesson. I mean, there's something, the poem is after Catalina Gugu, the Greek poet, anarchist poet, But it has something Brechtian about it to me, especially Brecht's manual for city dwellers from the mid-1920s, how to survive in hard city. So I use Bonnie as a kind of lesson, learning model. So Sean Bonnie was an anarchist or anarcho-communist, uncomfortable in some ways with trade union politics in which we were engaged. He was more comfortable in the squatted occupations, such as the last large student occupations in Britain, which were in 2010. There have been smaller occupations. Goldsmiths had a long occupation, but as a mass movement, it was 2010. Those were occupations in opposition to both spending cuts in education and the increase of student fees. They went up from £3,000 a year for British students to £9,000 a year. They're now £9,250 a year. Those demonstrations and occupations felt the full force of the police baton on several occasions. They really violent, heavy demonstrations. Within that movement, Sean Bonney met a younger generation of political and aesthetical comrades who, when he had gone, when he had died, mourned his departure deeply. The 2010 occupations were quite wild affairs. The students germinated social centres. It was a sort of model, I think, coming from Genoa, and I suppose it was part of that whole period of the movement of the squares, of Occupy. You know, so we could see this all maybe as a one wave, in a sense, now. So they had these social centres, and Bonnie would visit them, would read poems, and would all discuss politics all through the night. To protest against the university, to argue specifically in 2010, and then in smaller and other ways in 2014, 2018, 2019, 2020. But in all of those years, there was agitation against the university as it exists, is to ask for a new university, or in some ways to bring that into being as a premonition to set up through the processes of taking control of a situation and trying to find ways to learn and unlearn together. There was more popularity at that time of the 1960s movement of de-schooling, the anti-university. All the stuff from the 60s and 70s began to be rediscovered. In 2010, in their occupation in central London, students cultivated links to other university members, specifically the cleaners, the cleaning staff at the University of London. Many of them were from Colombia and other South American countries, were extremely militant, and certain bonds that last until this day were set up between the occupying students and the cleaners. Sean Bonney was one of many who signed a letter to the management of one of the colleges of the University of London, SOAS, who were proposing to evict students from a building that had stood empty for many years. I won't read the letter, but just to note, it was trying to make these links between students as workers and learners and cleaners as workers and learners, and just to propose, I suppose, a flattening of hierarchy and a shift in what we understand the purpose and pursuit of education to be. The students lost that battle and they were evicted very suddenly from this building. And the building was very quickly, which had stood empty for 20 years, it had been a part of the British Museum with Chinese ceramics, and then that finished, and it just stood there, nobody cared about it, but once the students had occupied it, it came into vision again, and so us t- turned it into an international graduate center so that they could attract more international students and take more fees. And they also had deportation raids on the cleaning staff, got them really, really nasty. After the movement of 2010 collapsed, Sean Bonney left London to become a research fellow at the Free University of Berlin. He was quite uncomfortable there. The stability of a salary was useful, but he didn't want to be in an institution, and he didn't identify with it. He didn't seek the comfort of success. And I find that kind of interesting because, you know, it implied a kind of hierarchy that he didn't want. And I suppose it made me, thinking about that, made me think about coming to Birkbeck 22 years ago, where I teach. When I came there, it was a part-time evening college for mature students. And I could indulge a fantasy, which I think wasn't so true in many ways, that there was more of an equality. I would be teaching people older than me, younger than me, and it didn't matter. And we people who came to Birkbeck did not have to have any qualifications. And some came and they had PhDs, but they wanted to do an arts BA. So, you know, it was an interesting model that doesn't... The market in education destroyed that model, so it's something of a different place now. Through all that period, I think I tried to live on, even as, you know, my wages grew. I didn't feel like I changed very much from when I was a student. I could deceive myself. I was just a curious person among other curious people. But now, to go to university, to be in university, to be a professor, to have fee-paying students and to have precarious teaching assistants and people who are stuck at the level of lecturer and can't move on, you know, is to recognize hierarchies all the time, and then to recognize, you know, we exist in an environment of ranking tables, senior management teams who are terrified of government, who keep changing their policies around higher education, and senior management keep then sending us in different directions. Very, you know, very difficult place. And it's all of that that I suppose led to these repeated strike movements, but and it's quite divided. I have many colleagues who either don't want to strike or just can't strike, cannot afford to lose their wages, or who feel privileged. You know, they don't identify themselves as workers. You know, they have jobs in intellectual labor, and they're lucky to have that job, so they don't want to jeopardize it, even as the whole thing collapses in many ways around us. What happens to, I mean, you know, Sean Bonney, actually his tenure in Berlin had come to an end, and he wanted to go to Athens to live in exactly hell. And he couldn't find a way to do that, and he couldn't find money to do that, so I believe he removed himself from the situation in that dramatic way. Some of us don't do that, and we become, you know, as you become older, you become drawn into management yourself in some way, or you not to stand up is to allow the perpetuation of the situation, and you're always being asked to cut more from less or to spread the slack, and we exist in like in a pot of boiling water. Its temperature is gradually rising, maybe more quickly now, and you know it gets hotter and hotter, and eventually we will anyway be destroyed by it. So Sean Body resisted, like any anarcho-communist, the thinking of the prosaic, boring, procedural workaday, you know, which many of us just kind of get along with because we have to, and we have bills to pay. At the top of the list of that boringness must be pensions, which is one of the main reasons behind the recent university strikes. We were striking when COVID hit, so many people on the picket line got COVID. That was about pensions. Then we balloted and we struck again this year, quite a number of days, and we will be balloting for strikes again in September. Kind of eternal term, the other thing. And in a way, that's another one of the injustices we face, that you know, we're compelled to think about things like pensions, to imagine our old, worn-out selves, and to plan for the fact that there's been a vast downgrading of what we've come to us and to new people, new entrants to the profession. It's just laughable what they would receive. So given that you know the struggle was about pensions, in some ways Sean Bonney was a strange ghost to conjure up. Sean Bonney was someone drawn to the kind of drama of the avant-garde, to the sort of, I guess, explosive sense of things, particularly the avant-garde culture of the Paris Commune. He was motivated and did poems in response to the conspiracies of Baudelaire, the horror visions of Blanqui, the delirium of Rimbaud and Verlaine. Rather than striking, being part of a withdrawal of labour in the name of better pay and conditions, he was more attracted to Paul Lafargue's tract from the 1880s, Le droit de la paresse, the right to be lazy or the right to idleness. Lafargue was responding to and parodying the socialist demand for a right to work. Rather, would be better to not do or to actively do nothing. Not doing as resistance, not laziness reevaluated as a positive trait or resistant act, but definitely a not doing or an undoing or an undoing of doing. In 2020 then, when another strike came, I was really struck by the outpouring of misery, of exhaustion, and anger that was going through this thing we call academic Twitter. It's an illusionary idea that all academics are on the same Twitter, but we'll talk about academic Twitter. And lecturers would testify to working 100-hour weeks, only sleeping 3 hours a night. They would talk in coded terms about vicious managers, abuse in the workplace, an impossibility to keep up, future immiseration, and this endlessly articulated desire to leave or to never have begun in this field of employment, which was once so desirable, even if it always demanded something very deep from the self, even if it always was a kind of confusion of self and job. That was the point of it. Now, what was demanded of the self by the job seemed to be too high and too unrewarding. a prize. I mean, now I notice the discussions on academic Twitter are much more about the impossibility of the younger people getting a job at all. Sometimes, in these status updates, I detected a little hyperbole. Now, hyperbole is a poetic technique of exaggeration to produce strong effect. And Sean Bonney's poetry was always hyperbolic, taking seriously that line in Adorno's Minima Moralia. Knowledge comes to us through a network of prejudices, opinions, innovations, self-corrections, presuppositions, and exaggerations. In short, through the dense, firmly grounded, and by no means uniformly transparent medium of experience. So there's something about to relate our experience is to sort of push it into these wildness and these exaggerations and this field dense with subjective orientation. So how far do we push it? We push it as far as we need to in order to glimpse something other. So I see it as a strategy. Only exaggerations are true in the field of knowledge of the self and revolutionizing the world. In defense of poetry, Percy Bysshe Shelley states, so this romantic poet states that poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. And I think in some ways poet, artist, maybe be substituted here. In being poetic, they feel the world, absorb it, and vomit it out again. And in picking through the causes of our sickness, we know it better in poetry than our daytime selves or our management kind of deep fake selves. Sean Bonney was one to cite a line from Jean Genet. Genet wrote Letter to the American Intellectuals. It was a talk given at the University of Connecticut, 18th of March 1970, first published as Bobby Seale, the Black Panthers, and Us, the White People. It was published in Black Panther newspaper, 28th of March 1970. So it averred the proximity of poetry and revolution, so Genet writes, as for the political thought of the Black Panthers, I'm convinced it originates in the poetic thought of Black Americans. We're realizing more and more that a poetic emotion lies at the origin of revolutionary thought. So Bonney liked to quote those lines. The words are good advice for turning the pain of being into a pain against being, a poetics of refusal. But Genet's line, his letter, then wanders into a territory that Bonney could not enter. He goes on to say, this is why we have to understand that it is on the basis of singular poetic emotions that Mao Zedong was led to revolutionary consciousness, later on to the Long March, then to the revolution called the Hundred Flowers Campaign, and finally to the Cultural Revolution, and of course the same for Ho Chi Minh. And the same is true for the Black Panther Party, which from the poetic resources of the oppressed people draws the will to elaborate a rigorous revolutionary. Genet succumbed, at least in rhetoric, to the Maoist illusion, and he could not extricate himself from his time or from a kind of thinking for him and through him in that time. He campaigned. He used the university system to appeal to white students to gain the support for the Black Panthers. He used the fringes of that system, not the system itself, not the university itself, which is for the most part against knowledge and against revolution, because it is for disciplinary specialism and the rewarding of conventional thinking. So he used its fringes, its networks, its student unions, and so on. So something different happens when a demand for learning takes place outside of the university, and not competitively but collectively, and in close accord with the grain of life and love. This is the poetry of which Genet speaks, emotions leading to consciousness, that he was consumed by what was happening on the world stage, the rise of Maoism in Europe, the support for Ho Chi Minh as an act of anti-imperialist commitment, cannot be subtracted from what it means to rethink the world as the world rethinks itself. And in thought, there will always mingle much that is dead or wrong, but thought is living and breathing too, and so can make mistakes. This is process of meddling and meshing in the world, a form of thinking for and in itself. Is it something else, the world becoming conscious of itself, of how thought, theory, ideas steer, like a sail, the winds of history, or the wounds of history? Thinking always happens in a place and a time. I read Georg Lukács's Antinomies of Bourgeois Thought, one of the chapters in, Reification of the Consciousness of the Proletariat in History and Class Consciousness. So I read the section, Antinomies of Bourgeois Thought, when I was in a 10-day student occupation at the University of Sussex in the 1980s. My teacher was Gillian Rose, and we were doing Modern European Mind, and that was the week's reading. You know, I was occupying, and we were all, you know, as students doing occupation, learning, reading groups, but I was a good student. I did my homework. This was an occupation, we called it 10 Days That Shook the University, in emulation of John Reed's book on the Russian Revolution, 10 Days That Shook the World. We got kicked out by the police in the end, and they wanted to throw me out of university, but my mother wrote a really contrite letter, please, please don't, and they let me stay. So. Here I am. But the point being, to read Lukács's Antinomies of Bourgeois Thought in that context, in the with the pressures of that moment and that space, outside the seminar room, meant that it came to make sense as a self-critical enactment of what praxis and theory-infused knowledge could be. To illuminate that, here it gets a little dense. So Lukács is talking about this ideal of knowledge becoming just a contemplation of formal connections, a discovery of laws which function in objective reality without the intervention of the subject. And he thinks this is terrible, and he will explain why. The critical elucidation of contemplation puts more and more energy into its efforts to weed out ruthlessly from its own outlook every subjective and irrational element and every anthropomorphic tendency. It strives with ever-increasing vigor to drive a wedge between the subject of knowledge and man, the human, and to transform the knower into a pure and purely formal subject. And Lukács says, here's the contradiction, you know, knowledge becoming this kind of objective knowledge which excludes human thinking and history and context and all of those things is the knowledge that exists within bourgeois society. So it's not false, it's the, you know, it's the true illusion in a sense. He goes on to expand on this, a little bit of a long quote, so maybe I'll just pick up from this. So maybe, from halfway down. On the one hand, men are constantly smashing, replacing, and leaving behind them the natural, irrational, and actually existing bonds, while on the other hand, they erect around themselves in the reality they have created and made a kind of second nature, which evolves with exactly the same inexorable necessity as was the case earlier on with the rational forces of nature. So they're sort of, arguing that we've smashed away sort of the irrational kind of past, and we make these institutions. But this act of reification, which is the relationship of subject to object within a bourgeois society, just means we build new institutions. institutions and then get trapped in them. So we're sort of stuck within this ever-gratifying, ever-hardening institutions in a world of unalterable, or an unalterable world of quantities which we're condemned to live in. Or this also provides the opportunity for this to become antinomical to itself. Our contemplation, you know, we're made to contemplate because we can't act in any meaningful way. So our contemplation leads to dreaming, which can lead to ethical demands, to utopian ideals, to a residual sense of being more than quantity, instead being imaginative humans whose thoughts wander. But this contemplative stance remains on the level of thought, infused by the world, but not able to infuse it. Reification cannot be overcome in thought. But thought, in the form of philosophy, as it grapples with the world and what it could be or ought to be, casts a glimpse at freedom, even if it cannot attain it. Perhaps the possibilities contained in a kind of bourgeois philosophy of freedom have been stymied too often. Attention turns in the age of the self to the capacities of the broken self. Poetry becomes the conscious assertion of subjectivity as it registers both the pain of the world and its possible supersession, wound and the word and the world. Poetry might be a whiff of the future that should be, though not the one we will likely get. It's a bomb of words, the barrel of a righteous gun. This is how Bonnie uses it. Poetry is not to do with sensitive observation, rather it's a scarring in and of language that has registered hurt and says no. It's a line delivered as negation of the prosaic. It's a manifesto in itself. It's a marking of the line that should not be crossed, as is the picket line. The picket line, too, is a small stab of future thinking, other being. Bonnie, indeed, in a short poem, brings the picket line, tiny revolution, together with poetic form, and with the cosmos or the planetary, the space of collective dreaming, in a long poem titled The Commons, but here's some tiny lines from it. This thing has 14 lines, as in picket lines, like Venus in a closing sky. This thing, this poem, like a picket line, is composed of a line and lines, and these lines block meaning, like they would block those who would too easily pass them or traverse them, and it will be redolent of love or a vision of the sky on a clear day and perhaps a universal gesture. Bonnie also cites Blanqui as an epigraph to a poem. This is a line from Blanqui he uses. It is the stupid practice of our times to complain instead of acting. Jeremiahs are the fashion. Jeremiah is found in all attitudes. He cries, he lashes, he dogmatizes, he dictates, he rages, himself the scourge of all scourges. Let us leave the elegizing clowns, those grave diggers of liberty. The duty of a revolutionary is to always struggle, to struggle no matter what, to struggle to extinction. So we struggle to become extinct. We have one duty, Blanqui and Bonnie tell us, to go beyond denunciation into action on the world, destructive, transformative, provocative, and to go down fighting. Blanqui ends, of course, defeated, trapped in prison of the world that's far worse than that of the Bastille, for it is illimitable and will be projected by him into the outer reaches of the cosmos, eternité, Barnes asked. Yet he will continue to struggle and scream against the whole cosmos and all that is wrong within it, whose wrongness only replicates more wrong, greater wrongness. We're forever outmaneuvered by what exists and oppresses us in ever new ways. We do not know what new things we'll be compelled to disagree with, but we should hold on to our principles, at least set ourselves against instrumentalization of theory-infused knowledge could be. To illuminate that, here it gets a little dense. So Lukács is talking about this ideal of knowledge becoming just a contemplation of formal connections, a discovery of laws which function in objective reality without the intervention of the subject. And he thinks this is terrible, and he will explain why. The critical elucidation of contemplation puts more and more energy into its efforts to weed out ruthlessly from its own outlook every subjective and irrational element and every anthropomorphic tendency. It strives with ever-increasing vigor to drive a wedge between the subject of knowledge and man, the human, and to transform the knower into a pure and purely formal subject. And Lukács says, here's the contradiction, you know, knowledge becoming this kind of objective knowledge which excludes human thinking and history and context, all of those things, is the knowledge that exists within bourgeois society. So it's not false, it's the, you know, it's the true illusion in a sense. He goes on to expand on this a little bit of a long quote, so maybe I'll just pick up from this, so maybe, from halfway down. On the one hand, men are constantly smashing, replacing, and leaving behind them the natural, irrational, and actually existing bonds, while on the other hand, they erect around themselves in the reality they have created and made a kind of second nature, which evolves with exactly the same inexorable necessity as was the case earlier on with the rational forces of nature. So he's sort of, arguing that we smashed away sort of the irrational kind of past, and we make these institutions. But this act of reification, which is the relationship of subject to object within a bourgeois society, just means we build new institutions and then get trapped in them. So we're sort of stuck within this ever-gratifying, ever-hardening institutions in a world of unalterable. An unalterable world of quantities which we're condemned to live in, or this also provides the opportunity for this to become antinomical to itself. Our contemplation, we're made to contemplate because we can't act in any meaningful way, so our contemplation leads to dreaming, which can lead to ethical demands, to utopian ideals, to a residual sense of being more than quantity, instead being imaginative humans whose thoughts wander. But this contemplative stance remains on a level of thought infused by the world, but not able to infuse it. Reification cannot be overcome in thought. But thought, in the form of philosophy, as it grapples with the world and what it could be or ought to be, casts a glimpse at freedom, even if it cannot attain it. Perhaps the possibilities contained in a kind of bourgeois philosophy of freedom have been stymied too often. Attention turns in the age of the self to the capacities of the broken self. Poetry becomes the conscious assertion of subjectivity as it registers both the pain of the world and its possible supersession, rooted in the word and the world. Poetry might be a whiff of the future that should be, though not the one we will likely get. It's a bomb of words, the barrel of the righteous gun. This is how volume uses it. Poetry is not to do with sensitive observation, rather it's a scarring in and of language that has registered hurt and says no. It's a line delivered as negation of the prosaic. It's a manifesto in itself. It's a marking of the line that should not be crossed, as is the picket line. The picket line, too, is the small stamp of future thinking, other being. Bonnie, indeed, in her short poem, brings the picket line, tiny revolution, together with poetic form and with the cosmos or the planetary, the space of collective dreaming, in a long poem titled The Commons, but here's some tiny lines from it. This thing has 14 lines, as in pathetic lines, like Venus in a closing sky. This thing, this poem, like a picket line, is composed of a line of lines, and these lines block meaning, like they will block those who would too easily pass them or traverse them. And it will be redolent of love or a vision of the sky on a clear day and perhaps a universal gesture. Bonnie also cites Blanqui as an epigraph to a poem. This is a line that Blanqui uses. It is the stupid practice of our times to complain instead of acting. Jeremiads are the fashion. Jeremiah is found in all attitudes. He cries, he lashes, he dogmatizes, he dictates, he rages. Himself the scourge of all scourges. Let us leave the elegizing clowns, those great figures of liberty. The duty of a revolutionary is to always struggle, to struggle no matter what, to struggle to extinction. So we struggle and become extinct. We have one duty, Blanqui and Bonnie tell us, to go beyond denunciation into action on the world, destructive, transformative, provocative, and to go down fighting. And Blanqui ends, of course, defeated, trapped in the prison of the world that's far worse than that of the Bastille, for it is illimitable and will be projected by him into the outer reaches of the cosmos, eternité, always asked. Yet he will continue to struggle and scream against the whole cosmos and all that is wrong within it. His wrongness only replicates more wrong, greater wrongness. We're forever outmaneuvered by what exists and oppresses us in ever new ways. We do not know what new things we'll be compelled to disagree with, but we should hold on to our principles, at least set ourselves against instrumentalization, against utilitarianism, against knowledge as profit generation. Can we imagine some sort of socialization of our thinking, our teaching, our learning, a collectivization of our thinking, our teaching, our learning? Thinking universally might mean to unthink it, to both smash, replace, and leave behind the natural, irrational, and actually existing bonds of the academy, while tying ourselves up in new institutions that may lead again to the ossification of thinking if it does not remain in constant argument with itself, recovering poetic reserves of injustice and intuition, slipping and sliding to not allow that which we have made but has become objective rule over, but has become objective rule over us. Be in and escape at the same time, our place, our language, while we know we're trapped by it, pushing outwards, being a collective subject on the point of discovering its potential agency, countering mood, wish, and setting growth into the world in whatever way we can. I finish here. I have one last manifesto gesture as I said at the beginning that, you know, I was asked to come up with this manifesto for an international university. So I modeled a very short manifesto on the manifesto-like work of Vorticist Wyndham Lewis in the journal Blast from 1914, where he has his list of, you know, to be condemned, the blasts, and his list of the good things, the blessings. So let's see. Blast the international university that sucks up international thieves. Bless the university that has unraveled itself and grounded business league to dust
and as one wall between it and the street. Blast the academic Marxist who carefully weighs up the ballast of the conjuncture in order to publish another paywalled article. Bless the messy thinking that cares not for fashion or prestige or journal rankings. Blast boring open access research that just prolongs the heavy moralism, the dull texts of academic hair splitters, lovely lines of Marx like academic hair splitters. Bless posters, memes, small press, stolen manuscripts, recycling and remaining silent at the right times, which is a kind of steal from the opening vignette in Ultra Bedroom's One History, where he praises, you know, pamphlets and fast thinking and so on. So that'd be my manifesto. Thank you for listening.
On to my presentation, which I believe lot of which. So, for this presentation, I'd like to present some practicalities of the higher education system that would present significant roadblocks to the development of Station, because we've been thinking about accreditation in Station and moving the summer school as school into an accredited program for some years. So as our case example, attaining degree granted status, so we're in that system. I'll also present on how the American model of education works, some of its virtues and problems, and what we are facing imminently in innovating our systems. When I say our, I mean North American higher education systems, and by proxy, European, and for sure by proxy, Kosovo. Our systems of higher education. As a statistic, the US government holds 92% of student debt loan. So in our system, we don't get free education. We borrow money from the government. Everyone is guaranteed it. Bill Gates will not be denied a loan. Every person can borrow X amount of dollars from the government. And then the government holds that loan. The other 8% is held by private banks. So imagine we have a state system that holds this massive debt. How much is that? Ready? The total student debt, this is from 2019, is a massive $1.7 trillion. So that's the largest debt that the US government holds. So it's against our own students, myself included. I still owe money for my education. And that's from the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System. So I didn't invent those numbers. I took them today from the 2019 cost damages review. So Albert asked me to do a little personal history, and I'll do so because I'm an artist and an experiential learner. So that gets very difficult with certain kinds of theories, but I always have to physically go through something. I have to make an object of it somehow. I have to be in the place to actually learn it. And I always see something different in that creation. So here's a little bit of my personal story. I have a unique journey in education. And as an educator in the arts, I started, I'm a Generation Xer. We're an interesting generation, almost forgotten now. In a rather standard, middle of the road, high school experience in New Jersey. I was born about 20 miles east of New York City. I didn't know it at the time, but it turned out that New Jersey schools tested among the top in the nation between Connecticut and New Jersey. So what I thought was crap was actually probably pretty good. But what does it mean to me? I was just like our objects formed into it somehow. Out of high school, not knowing what to study, but knowing that delaying study would be problematic, I enrolled in a local community college. So I'll give you a short background on that. There's 50 US states. Each state has something like a UP system, a state university system, sometimes two of them or three of them. And then as a public education model, many counties have their own schools. Some of them are mandated to do that. Why? Universal access to higher education is mandatory as part of the laws of the United States. And you can't ask everybody to move to another part of the state or another state in order to study. So you have to provide something local for people to go to. And then we're concerned with larger populations. So adult education, continuing education, not just theory, but all sorts of different kinds of practices. So the community college system is in a way a social network system in the States that provides low cost education. If I told you the fees, you would, you know, like the college I work at now, the low cost is $13,000 a year. So that's low cost for, you know, the States. Thank God it's only that or something. So, you know, I started there. Again, I was very enrolled in the college to finish a degree in musical performance for classical guitar. I played guitar, that's the thing I liked. I suppose I should study it before any time passes by and fits them. There I found some of the most effective and generous professors of my life, but again, it turned out that a lot of those professors were coming from Princeton, Rutgers, and New York schools, so it was saturated with the region I was in. Again, like our object, I was born into it. From here, with the excellent grades, I could apply to nearly any school in the United States and have a reasonable chance to compete for a spot in the program. So some schools are competitive, even the state schools. Rutgers was competitive, and that's where I went. After applying around to in-state and out-of-state to a number of excellent schools, I settled at Rutgers and pursued a philosophy. And again, not knowing what I would do with my life, I thought I better learn to think. And then if I can do that, then I have some other choices moving forward. It was a wonderful school, great experience. And then I spent a lot of my elective hours at Rutgers Mason Gross School of the Arts. That's their art college there, largely in photography along the way. We can talk more about electives than that. Part of choosing Rutgers was, again, this financial decision. It was less expensive for me to stay there. I simply couldn't afford the out-of-state tuitions, but if I think it was at that time something like $30,000 a year to go to my own in-state college. Maybe it was less than that, but I got grants, so you don't have to pay back. They always manage it to make you feel like you're getting a value, but then you come out and it's like massive bills, so it's not really a value. They tricked me. After graduating Rutgers with a degree in philosophy, I spent a year at a studio arts program in Florence, Italy. So for me, that was a kind of strange dream that doesn't happen to some kid from the suburbs, from a lower middle class family. So I did that. And it was very much a neophyte at that time to European history and politics, other than what I learned in high school. Though I had studied art and art history, in a pre-decolonial education model, now we're in a whole different model, that was firmly Eurocentric. So now we're looking at it in different ways, there are some positives to that and some negatives to that. It's certainly nice because we have to write new textbooks. Here's opportunity to the next generation, maybe even a Generation Xer, we'll see. This was an amazing education and experience with the majority of faculty from Italy and widely versed and competent in museology, museum studies, curatorial studies, and studio arts practices. I opened my eyes quite a bit. As a graduate student, we each had a private studio and a collective loft to produce work in. It was also expensive, but accredited through a US accreditation body, and this is what I'll focus on later, this accreditation situation. From here, I spent a year off taking classes at the University of Iowa, that's in the center of the country, and always enrolled in some program. I'm a continuing education human, so I like to learn and I like to keep myself up to date. That was an important school of art with such alumni as Anna Mandietta, the performance artist, and Tennessee Williams, the playwright. Then came a journey of applying around to the most notable graduate MFA programs, nearly all of which were too expensive and unrealistic. Yale University, anything that could give me the possibility of doing international travel and teaching later in life. I settled on the Rochester Institute of Technology because I felt the need to have more skills than just theory. I was working in photography. It was a shift from chemical to digital. I knew that I needed to learn technologies to be relevant. And I needed to make a living afterwards or have career choices other than starving studio artists, which I've seen enough of. That's really cool when you're 25, but when you're 40, you're a loser, And so I needed a way out of that in some way. And if anybody's still doing that, you're not a loser. Still living. or an artist activist, or an artist educator activist. So these things come into play. So post-graduation, I immediately began teaching across a range of schools in art and design, using my theoretical, but more successfully my practical skills with computer-aided design and installation. In 2010, I moved to Kosovo to teach in the then-fledgling American University of Kosovo, which is now RIT Kosovo. And if anybody wants to know why that name changed, I know all the dirt, and I can tell you exactly why. A satellite campus of my alma mater, the Rochester Institute of Technology. I ended my time in Kosovo just before the pandemic, having served then as the vice president for academic affairs and vice president of the college. So I got experientially to see the administrative side and the board side and the whole and the accreditation side. So I was I had my experience now. I could form my objects in my mind, like our object here, based on real experience. So defining problems in the arts education model. It is worth delineating what we mean by art in this context. Often, I think, to make a distinction between fine art, an antiquated term but important for legacy, and art. Art and art practice have a lot of encroachment from other disciplines. Everybody wants the art, what was traditionally known as fine arts. They want that because it's exciting, because it's object. Social value in being an artist and being successful at it. It's one of the highest things you can be, and that's through millennium. So, so other disciplines naturally want to find out what's happening in the arts. On one hand, this is good because territoriality and strict boundaries leads to silo thinking. It really squashes innovation, or at least has a higher potential to squash innovation. On the other hand, the balance of resources and competition for engaged and talented students gets diluted as theory is removed from integrated practice and explored inside another discipline, which begins to claim authority in the arts. Okay? As an example of this would be the contemporary communications faculty. Apologies if anybody's from the communications faculties here. Communication was traditionally, communications as a faculty was traditionally in the modern era more aligned to journalism, mass communication, broadcast practice and ethics. Though recently in the postmodern era has become a conversant theoretical practice that explores artistic practice and intent through the viable lens of explorative practices birthed by the digital. So the fine arts provided more exciting, not so limited, creative opportunities that could be explored within the discipline of communication theory, and the crossover created an option, a competitive one, that draws students away from studio practice for the promise of a practical career post-graduation. The department and faculty wars are always about a fight for resources. Usually if there's a battle, there's a resource that's either too scarce or perceived as scarce. So there's a fight, and that's in practice and in theory, including recent and current wars that are happening right here in Europe. The part of the faculty wars are always about resources, which include students in the US model, because students provide the tuition dollars to the $1.7 trillion debt. To pay salaries and purchase equipment in the private and public sector. Semester credit hours, generating higher levels of semester credit hours, is the mathematical game watched by administrators that defines any viable success metric. It's a business, and that's the capitalist model of higher education in the States, however flawed that model is. Regardless of ideology, in the US where higher education is not free or provided by the state, this competition needs a firm review as more and more higher education institutions cut arts programs as a mode of survival. There are many more examples, but I believe address for now and discuss more later. I will add, I share my colleague's thought. When you have £30,000 education per year, and where does that money go? Here I can tell you that a campus of 500 students up the hill would be a tuition of 6,000 euros a year for Kosovo standards, which seems high, was barely enough to get the quality, education quality needed. So, and I was the one who crunched the numbers, so I saw it from a different angle. It's amazing how the money gets eaten up. Accreditation bodies. To be a viable program that has value across cultures, any program needs to be accredited by a respected state, regional, or international accreditation body. This is the power of higher education at the moment. Those accreditation bodies define the physical aspects of the campus as well as pedagogical methods and assessments. This is a model, however, that was built starting from the late 19th century and really cemented its foundational principles, largely unchanged until now, in the 1950s. So we're living the end of modernism, accreditational standard of higher education, but we are not living in a world of high modernism anymore. We're far past that. The value of this is noble to combat fraud within the higher education institutions through intense review. In the United States, the mechanism for control and punishment is, of course, removing funding. If the schools rely on tuition dollars come from the government can stop that flow of money and then punish the schools. So it's a very tricky game of playing this out. A college or university not meeting accreditation standards would be barred from receiving federal funds, which in the vast majority of cases would be catastrophic to the institution and force its closure. It would also open up the opportunity for civil lawsuits against the entity. All of this inside the high capitalist system, of course, if it's working and functioning properly. It's worth a discussion about how such mechanisms would work in a free higher education system, one not based on market competitions, which will perhaps be a different kind of discussion and an important one that will happen. What are the society's foundational principles in defining education success, or even educational market? In Kosovo, there's a struggle between these two systems that, in my experience, confused and stymied accreditation processes and innovation. The accreditation system would require Stazione in our example, if it were to become a year-round degree-granting unique arts institute, to build a library. The growing volume of books and resources, as one example, physically, they would need to provide that to even qualify to be accredited and get degree granting status. No account for current technologies has been proposed in the value system of higher education that recognizes libraries have been digitized, and there are technologies available where an institution can provide a large volume of library electronically, maybe through subscription or open source, that's another story. A swift, mobile, and effective program like Summer School is School, which I truly believe, it's really a lovely program. I learn something every year. I always go back rejuvenated from this program. It's one of the best I've seen in Europe. Probably makes it all feel good right now, but it's true, so I can constantly support it despite the very difficult circumstances of keeping the place running. The summer school in Statuon would have an almost insurmountable dilemma in gathering capital funds to provide an antiquated necessity in order to gain access to the accreditation affirmations and liabilities. So there are colleges across the education sector that are calling for reform of the accreditation process, which would allow the smaller, efficient, unique, and focused programs like Stazione's to have a competitive value. Why wouldn't you want that in a society, right? Reform of accreditation is necessary if a decentralized model is to be centralized or decentralized education. Finally, I'd like to discuss the centralized model versus the decentralized model of higher education. Programs of higher education allow for credits to be transferred between institutions. That's your money when you're a student. You get your credits and you can do something with it, and you can build it into a degree, and then the state gives you a degree. The number of credits that are allowed is set either by state or by at the institutional level. This allows partial mobility between institutions, with one defined as the degree-granting institution and the others where you can transfer credits into your institution. The curriculum that is needed, i.e. the course descriptions, learning outcomes, delivery methods, must be significantly matched between the institutions for the credits to be transferred. It limits innovation. Each semester credit hour is a financial plus for a higher education institution, so there's an incentive to deny credits that don't have a direct equivalent to the institution's degree granting program. One attempts to transfer credits from another institution, like Statsio, for example. This regulation puts checks and balances on some programs because there needs to be some agreement on the foundation of knowledge principles, like our object here. We have the same one, and we share it between our mind right now. But for each, it's also different in some sense. For the most part, however, the accreditation bodies provide a framework that also limits innovation and favors capital over substance, money over actual education. Post-war Kosovo saw a boom of higher education, with a number of very low-quality programs emerging at now-dead institutions. For example, and an outcry for regulations. The regulations, of course, always favor the state, and UP has, and will be forever, the only university in Kosovo. This has to do with the rules of accreditation, borrowed from much more highly populated states that require an unattainable number of enrolled students, which only UP can gather, and the number of full-time, terminally degree professors credentialed to deliver postgraduate programs like MFA, PhD, EdD, and the like. The system is then pushed by design to be centralized, controlled, and becomes a political entity of the highest order. A better decentralized model is possible. I think a good parallel would be the structure of the internet, a multinodal system of lateral connections that allows for far more mobility and liberal art space nodes of forming a degree granting entity. The push to reform the current model and its power structures will be admittedly highly complex and require fierce debate, to which the entities with huge endowments lobbying for the bottom line, I think the Ivy League schools, will have as much money as the student debt. As a business model, there's no way around this in practice, despite the value of the theories behind this changes needed. I won't give up on that. The reform of the accreditation system will be the key to the reform that proposes in France. One can't happen without the other. So we have to get to one level lower in that foundational system and reform that. A word about a new initiative. One way to function that may be fruitful is to create institutes in or around colleges and universities, and this is what I'm doing. The institute would allow rapid development and organic change driven pedagogy through professional practice that can be leveraged by the degree program. By this I mean practically, a program like Statio can be integrated as modules inside the existing accreditation system. So that's before we reform the accreditation system. This eliminates the initial red tape and slow-moving committee work, along with the political positioning and administration before ideas are fully formulated. In New Jersey, colleagues and I have created such an institute, the Alpha Arts Institute. That would be a partnership organization with Statsio and possibly others moving forward, with backing of the college, so I can use my position within that college to do to reform which will provide space, access, support for the Institute, visiting scholars and artists to, through dialogue with local academics and professionals, help guide and build the structure for this immovable feast. So in conclusion, the accreditation process is the powerful word for success in education models in Western countries currently and looking out into the future. Reform of that accreditation process needs to account for the new methodologies and institution building for the 21st century. It's time. It's way past time. It's 50 years past time for that. And if this system is unlikely to change, either because there's no political will and or if there's resistance from established institutions, then establishments of institutes or similar entities that can operate to develop that structure internally. Think of like mold growing rocks that crack it open somehow, can operate with the structures, maybe a good mechanism for doing so, survival for the independent institutes, which Bob's speaking at now, will require these mechanisms for support. And if you're students, it's worth thinking about how the heck you're going to engage in that process and fight not the demon of the institute, but the accreditation body. So with that, and our object, which I hope stayed with you, and is now between us, now a living creature, so we do have a power ground.
Thank you, Daniel. I would like to give the floor now to Besa Luzha to conclude this round of observations and thoughts and ideas and whatnot.
Very difficult task.
I mean, just to summarize her work briefly, Esther is a British academic, but says she did a PhD in the United Kingdom. She paid the fees.
International
piece
myself.
As an investment, let's say.
But also,
but also heavily involved in the Ministry of Education in many, many operations, let's say. And works in syllabuses, from accreditation of technical arts, she's all over the place. Informally, you can also say that without her, not many things are possible in the Ministry of Education on behalf of a sector which is not directly politicians. So, and very often she's used, I always hope, for the benefit of the rest or the end receivers of the education here. I'm happy that you could find them to be with us in this panel tonight, on this Saturday. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Albert. I feel very honored and privileged to be among you. I have been collaborating with some scholars from a different perspective while working at the German Foundation for the Other Stiftung. We somehow found a way how to support this, which is not eligible to be supported by a political foundation. And we found somehow the way to the discussion that go on here, like one thing, and the ideological lenses that are somehow used and presented by the artists who participate in the programs, made it possible for me to justify the support for, partial support for the summer program by focusing on the content of that. Ideological discussion of mankind, because in Germany the supporters are structured very well, and there is another foundation that is eligible to support art, and the political foundations are eligible only to support certain, let's say, activities which will allow them to promote ideology. So in our case, we will promote the social democracy, the left, all the values that are made. But my story is somehow connected with all the thoughts and the things that you presented. I'm a musician, I'm a pianist, by profession. As a good student of art was in elementary or high school, I somehow couldn't decide, and then also the influence of my parents were like, only music is too good, so you should also go some, because then the whole knowledge and the success would be wasted if you become a musical artist. And I studied both economy and music at the same time in the University of Pristina. Later on, because of our circumstances in Kosovo, when I finished, when I took my diploma in piano in 1994, I was already in the fourth year of the parallel system that we had. I had only the chance to finish 1 year of the normal university life and the university building and circumstances. And then from the second year, we went on in this parallel education system that you have probably all learned about it. And we used every house and space and object that we could. So you can imagine how that was in that time to study music from a situation where we all together, so it's not only everybody, learned and sang and performed together in the choir and orchestra in a normal big hall. As a little dream of that, we were using the same object that we are using now, which was a pedagogical school building, not really art or music faculty, let's say, infrastructure. But still, there was a big room. We ended up in a small place, which later on was used by the Mendoza as the headquarters in Peyton Street, which was hard enough to have one piano there, and we could somehow have monthly concerts where we performed and presented our learning skills at the time that we studied, for example, in my case, the art of the piano performance. The other studies of the economy degree that I was pursuing, but this was in that time marketing and economy, which was completely based still like in that time with the transition between the socialist economy that we had learned in the past. Now, as we moved on and we left socialism somehow, we were still using the old books, but pretending to study economics at those times in some houses in suburban area here in Pristina or any other room like this, maybe, or some house or garage where you could go and have lectures about macroeconomy, finance, and marketing and research and all this. Somehow we finished both. And later on, I decided to continue for music education because there was no opportunity to perform in Kosovo from 1991 until 1999. And somehow, the period in 1994, when I graduated, was almost like I said goodbye to my performing piano career. I got married, I started a family life, and sooner, we were cut in the middle of the war, and there was no thinking about my performance or studying anything other than surviving and trying to live and to continue our life. Somehow, some of us went in refugee camps in Austria, in other circumstances. Some died, some survived. Somehow we came back in 1999. 1998, before this war started, somehow in this still very absurd situation in the university life at the Faculty of Academy, we were still thinking how to develop the research at the time. For the first time, the idea came to develop the master's program in the Faculty of Arts. The Faculty of Arts of University of Pristina is relatively young. It has been established since 1975. So I was 3 years at that time. And drama, music, and arts department were somehow together in one Faculty of Arts. At that time, when it was created, it was still, you know, about this maybe legacy of studying art for the fulfillment, for the enrichment, for the expression, for the communication, for giving out the messages, the artistic messages through different mediums, under the ideology of communism system in which we were, and everything was supported and being paid by the state. You simply had to have a talent and you would be admitted in the faculty, there would be no fees, and you would then also be supported later on to go to have exhibitions, to follow them in other. We were not isolated, for example, as in the Albanian case. So our first artists became also art teachers. The first generation immediately got, without being, let's say, research degrees and publishing papers or doing all the stuff that we are doing now, they were immediately hired to be the teachers. So the first generation of the painters, of the composers, of the musicians became also the first art teachers. And they started to, at the beginning, the interest was relatively small, maybe 5 to 6 students would enroll, and there was 1 or 2 teachers, let's say, per discipline. There were also some teachers coming from other centers of Yugoslavia to help, because this institution was really progressive. So by that time, 1998, it was the first time that there was an idea to have a postgraduate studies in our arts, and I happened to be the first one to apply. I was a pianist, so normally you would think you would have to continue in postgraduate studies of piano, so improving more your skills. But at that time, one of the professors who was teaching the methodology of music teaching had a very interesting idea. She said, I want somebody who is pianist, but also somebody who has studied at the same time something else, like gymnasium or something else, because they would have to know to write and to read rather than just, you know, performing and being a good music student. At that generation, it happened to be me as a proposal that came from my piano teacher to this teacher, and although I went with my husband and with my daughter in Greece, in Creta, for, you know, some, because at the time nobody worked, so everybody had to find some way to live. My husband had lived before in Greece, so he said, let's go back, it would be better life there. And because of that, I had to come back from Greece actually to enroll in this first program. And from that moment, I changed completely my approach. I became a music teacher postgraduate and finished that, and later on, because of my professional career, and I became a university teaching assistant. If I wanted to become a university professor, I needed a doctoral degree. So at that time, there was no doctoral degree possible, neither in Albania, neither in Macedonia, neither in any of the regional close centers where I could do so. I researched and I saw the one in London, which was a very good opportunity for me to, include all my practical knowledge, but then only learn the research skills and the theories and the methodology. And by that, having a degree of an education doctorate, accrediting my research skills for the needs of my professorship tenure, but also for, I used it very well then for advancing the research master's program at our faculty. So it was a brief story why I became so involved in this. In the Faculty of Arts, since the Bologna, since 1999, when we came back after all that went, we restarted our, let's say, university, we came back to our institution and buildings, and here are the experiences now from the UK, from the US, and from others through the Bologna system came to us. We were not part of the Bologna, but because of the international system here, were somehow obliged to implement the standards and procedures. I had written some papers about that during my doctoral degree, but I experienced myself because I was the ECTS coordinator for the Faculty of Arts. That was an adventure that I need to write more about, how I ended up explaining to the art professors, drama professors, famous artists, which stood in front of me like a school pupil. I was like, please tell me, please tell us, what is this? What do I have to do? How do I have to transform? What is this CCTS? Why it's 25? My subject is more valuable. Why should I put 5 in the CCTS? And then this experience, which is that it's not about you, it's not about the subject, it's about the hours that the student has to engage within the scope of all that. It was a very interesting experience and struggle. And I saw, because as I said, in the time when the University of Kosovo Pristina started, it was more an institution for the general emancipation of our population, which until 1968, the older movements in other countries were led by students from all other reasons. We had fought and asked for a university. Because we saw university as something which would promote our political rights and our equal participation in that creation of the political participating in Yugoslavia was at that time. So it was about also about the identity, about the national rights of the Albanians within the structure that was existing at that time, rather than just learning and having some degrees and having some skills and having some, you know, it was more than that. It was a social collective emancipation process, and we were so proud of that, and that's why, you know, the eyes of the Albanian community in Kosovo University was like at the highest point. So where we are now, and with all these developments that came from international influences, and when we came back in 1999, the entire international administration drew different models. But most of them were neoliberal, and they had to do with standardization, with tests, with measurements, with boxes, and how to fit and how to adapt, even an arts degree into all the system procedures. And our professors who were there, because they loved art, because they thought they were free in the past to teach the students within their own disciplines and to learn to teach them to create their own disciplines further, were somehow challenged by being asked to explain what they do in the syllabuses. And we have high effect experience, but I had to write the syllabuses for most of the subjects that our colleagues taught, because they just didn't know how to use the language that were required by the accreditation process. Beyond that, we were now asked to, how to say, be measured by hours, by numbers, by credits. There was a question in the university discussion, why do we teach one-to-one in certain subjects, like in music or in arts, in groups? Why, for example, our teaching hours are equally valid as a professor who teaches 1,200 students? Why we should be paid the same? Why we should be counted the same, let's say, number of hours for our contracts? Because we have to explain all the time the specifics. But sometimes the specifics also were misused, if I may say, also from our art community in order to avoid, you know, procedures. So it was kind of a battle between us, and I, as a member of the accreditation, the first accreditation we lost. Because when they came, the department was not ready, they couldn't produce anything. And you had people who, all the younger generations were taught by them, they were role models, their paintings were, you know, being in all the institutions. And now there comes an institution that says, no, you didn't fill the criteria. And it was translated as like, it will be closed, doesn't pass, there will not be any more arts faculties. So it was also a political situation involved. But simply it was people there didn't know to handle the process, didn't know to express in the language that it was required. What do we do? Why do we have painting and sculpture and this and that and all the disciplines? And why do we teach individually? Why do we teach in groups and all the situation? And then we had to take over from there, and there they cut us an extra process. to adapt and to fill in all the gaps and to deliver all the additional documents. There were difficult 2 years after that, and we finally somehow managed. But it was still only the technical, the paper thing. The situation in the faculty didn't become better because it was still fragmented as it was in the past. Each discipline was a state on its own. The professor was like a king. He didn't allow the others to intervene. There was no interaction between the, let's say there was no interdisciplinarity in within the, let's say, visual arts family, let alone between visual, drama, music. And the tendencies that were coming from these structures are international, because as a country in transit, we couldn't develop our own model, so we would combine them with French and UK and American and German, whatever was coming from the experts that was sent to help us, we somehow tried to adopt it and to match it with the material, with the clay we had in our own department. And it was a difficult process, and along this process we made a lot of mistakes, of course. And there was one point after the second accreditation where we saw that it could not function because, for example, the requirements were very difficult for us to reach. For example, for one study program to have three professors with doctoral degrees or in arts area equivalent. What is the equivalent of a doctoral degree in arts? Nobody could be describe, but they somehow, it somehow meant that it's okay if that they don't have a doctoral degree, but at least they should be regular professors. And we didn't have a number of regular professors for each subject or study program, because as I said, each discipline was a study program almost as a department itself. What did we do? Using my experience of the studies in London, the programs I saw, the research and the functioning of the research school that I saw in the University of London Institute of Education, I tried to convey the message of, let's say, collaboration and simplifying the paper programs. It was also money. Each program, it was told to us, was costing about let's say maybe 6,000 euros or something like that to be accredited. Only music department has 9 programs. The painting has had also another 9, and drama had 4 or 5, only in bachelor level. Added to the master level, so we had about 30 study programs that had to be accredited without having all the stuff and costing so much money. So the largest challenge in the process for me is for a young colleague, looking at my colleagues who were there, you know, the personalities that we had respect and public figures, and so was to explain to them the model that we wanted to push forward in order to get the accreditation. And the model was to simplify and to get all these similar, let's say, study programs, which meant subjects or disciplines, into one study program. And I used the first model in the music department by merging, let's say, all the different instruments study program, like violin, piano, viola, and everything, into one performance program. So bachelor of music performance and master of music performance, and then also bachelor of music education and masters of music education. It had its own challenges because, for example, we had a composing program which couldn't fit the performance, couldn't fit the education. It had to be a program on its own, but we didn't have the stuff. We had the composers, but they were already marked and ticked within the music education program, so we had a composing program without professors mainly. And so we had to find to be created, so we included the composer into the Masters of Music and Bachelor of Music without specifying that it's education, and then having 2 sub-profiles saying one is for education, one is for composing. And this model that we had to live with lots struggle and resistance and challenge it came after 2 or 3 years later that finally the drama and the visual department also understood that there's no other way than doing that in order to be accredited, in order to be, let's say, validated by those instruments. So this is about the technical part. The other part that we as artists in the, let's say, artistic higher education institution in Kosovo are always struggling with is also presenting and defining the artistic work and the artistic research. Not only the artistic research, but the artistic product itself. I am a member of lately one of the university committee that has to do regulation for the master studies. So until now, there was not a general university regulation, how it is in other universities, which explains, you know, not only the structure, but also like the procedure. How do you apply for the thesis, how it is accepted, how long it should be, and all these things. So they are doing now finally for the university. They had one, obviously, but they are changing now because it couldn't fit. And we saw it in practice because, for example, when we listed the subject diploma in our syllabus and in our program, the administration in the faculty and also in the university didn't accept musicians, for example, diploma, the artistic diploma, for example, a pianist would have a recital or a concert with orchestra, perform with two pianos because we don't have the capacity to do it within the faculty, but they still didn't recognize it as a diploma. When they went to the referent to present, I have finished, here is the evaluation from my professors and from the jury and everything. Where is your diploma? But I have just given you the results. No, no, where is the written diploma? The thesis. You know?
Yeah.
It's like, well, we didn't write anything. I know that it's not valid. I cannot issue the diploma. So this was like 2 difficult years trying to negotiate politically through university, through council, through media, through everything. And in this latest a committee meeting that I participated just now in the beginning of July, again we came at this, and I said, look, an artistic production in the end, maybe an exhibition, maybe a documentary, maybe a performance, maybe whatever, you know, the artist uses medium to produce or to perform or to exhibit or to create. That is the artistic diploma. We cannot do anything else. No, you have to have something to write because we have to have a procedure. The committee has to evaluate it before it's happened. You cannot evaluate the performance before it happens. You can have a rehearsal. The rehearsal is not the one. So we are still at this, and my responsibility is now to find language and ways in other universities and in other models to satisfy the procedures that they have foreseen in order to make it for the artists, for the drama, visual, and musicians, that their final diploma work is judged for what they produced. It's okay to write something that can be a discussion, as Bernhard explained, in case of one of the students, like the discussion how he came to that model, or how he developed, or how he understood, for example, Mozart's work before reading the academic. It's enough. That is another element to be judged from the final artistic product or work that needs to be judged by people who will assess the artistic work. Here we are, at this stage, we are still having to explain this. And
that's
I'm trying to define.
That's for undergraduate work, right?
For undergraduate and masters.
Right.
This is what the regulation is for masters.
Yeah.
For the undergraduate, they have kind of passed. We have found the model. For example, the performers will only bind the word that they perform with the 3 stages, maybe evaluation of what they felt while they studied this work and performed this work. This is like the procedural challenges that we in Kosovo right now still are facing along with administrative procedures, and then we come to artistic research and to the PhDs and to the publishing professor assistant, and then I have published some works in valid and impact factor journals. I have a chapter published in a book edited by two very famous professors. It's called Origins and Foundations of Music Education. It's a kind of chronology of the history of music education development in all the world, and I did it for the chapter for Kosovo. And that's only enough for the professor associate, the second level. And if I need to be promoted further, I have to publish more in the journals. And but it's okay if you really are into that kind of research. Research about music education, about music history, about teaching, about practice and everything. But there's no possibility, for example, to judge or evaluate the real artistic research that the performers are doing. They have invented now some, for example, the performers have to count the performance. But because of this, provinciality mentality that we live, we have to be judged by international. So if you do a concert in Pristina, even though you may play the best or the most difficult concerto with the Philharmonic Orchestra, at some point the people in the university said, oh, no, this is not enough. It has to be published somewhere. Where it should be published? In a website. In which website? Who would publish a performance of your concert? Whatever. Well, you have to publish or to play in Vienna or in London. You know, another fight for that. We came now to a situation where at least we have defined points, like how much is valid one concert with the harmony, how much is valid one recital, how much is valid one single performance with somebody at a concert. I know this is now the measuring instrument, and there's nothing about the quality. You may have played rubbish at all these concerts, but all they count will be the number of the concerts. And if they found that you have played at least five, that's sufficient to promote you, as I said, no critics, no quality judgment about that. And we are fighting it from within, but as an art community, we are small. And then it's always this, like, but you don't want to be judged, you are trying to use the specificity and your, how to say, artistic role to avoid procedures, standards, and you cannot be left alone in this world where we others are also measured all the time. So this is the fight we are currently in. There's no other way. We finally got rid of this, let's say, international ranking, because if we are playing in Vienna, we will be in Vienna, we will be here. There are some artists who also perform in concerts outside of Kosovo, and we really have very good artists who are teaching, but they should not be measured only by those criteria. And also the criteria for the employment. For example, the criteria for an artist to have necessarily a PhD was a hinder for us to employ, let's say, good young staff at the university, because there might be a very freelance artist who is very well known in different disciplines, but he didn't pursue an academic career. Like, for example, I have to mention when in these debates, the names of the famous artists, which our society is very proud of, and they hang on to these names, in order to fight for an argument to say, no, we shouldn't lose. So I kind of managed to prevent the criteria that fantastic artist would be dismissed in the time of application if he didn't or she didn't have a PhD in a register. And I said, okay, let's take Petri Cic. He doesn't have a PhD. Because he is the best guitarist in all Europe, maybe right now. Would you dismiss him because he doesn't have a PhD in comparison to a mediocre guitarist just because he has a PhD on something, or a guitar technique, or a guitar repertoire, or history, or whatever? 5 points, but then the points of the artistic life and numbers of artistic performance would count and would make the people eligible to be students. I mean, young teaching staff that are aging, rather, teaching staff at the Faculty of Arts. So it's quite a challenge, and I share it. I don't want to repeat all what you have said, but coming from that level where you are, and we are taking you as a point of reference, we are experiencing that even in a more difficult way, because we have more difficult challenges with our own people and the structures and the procedures and the institutions level and the policy documents in order to allow for more, not flexible, but more open, more artistic, let's say, life in our arts institutions. And we have only one public institution, as Daniel mentioned, the University of Pristina has the Faculty of Arts with the 3 departments. For until now, it was the only. Now, recently, there have been some others like different programs in different universities, private colleges and private institutions, like maybe digital graphic design or digital design programs, drama, like AB faculty, also music, and now with the idea of the community college and going rather to the students not having all of them in Pristina, we also have now public universities in Prizren, Pia, and Jakova, which again, if they are measured by the same standards, they will not fulfill the status of university. With political decision, they will allow, and lately in the higher education law, when we discussed if we want to change it, we had levels to say the position of saying, if it's, even if it's public or private, if it fulfills the criteria, it shall be named university. But if it's not, it shall not be having the name of the university, even if it's created by the parliament and so on and so forth. That's why the law is still not brought in parliament, and it's very difficult to agree, but that shall pass for the moment with all other problems that are on the situation. I don't know if it's, I don't want to make it any longer, but if you have any questions, because I thought after all this, insights very helpful and very familiar to me. I thought you as international members of this activities within the summer school would be more interested in the current practical challenges that we are facing as an art institution.
Thank you so much, Besa. Thank you. Let's invite the chair. You can stay there, Besa, because we'll just invite the rest of you to sit. Have some questions and the discussion of the rest of the but also why not among yourselves and you can just get to listen and enjoy. Just one quick remark, if I may. Even though the experiences coming from the outside are always valuable, I think it's possible you still can craft the system. Right? And these examples are those who tell that some mistakes can be corrected faster, let's say. So if you have some people in right positions, the system is still quite fresh. There it's fresh and you can still design.
But also the problems are really the same.
Yeah. Yes, they are the same. But the possibilities for change
are the same, no.
Possibilities for change.
I mean if I appear to be
but are I think larger,
bigger.
And that's but you would have, for instance, if you have a person like this in the visual arts sector at the University of Pristina, there would be more, I think, possibilities. Unfortunately, Besa is a musician. And she was helping a lot with the visual arts department and faculty of arts. But this is reality. Then it comes to people. You know, Bernard said, maybe I'm getting old, I'm getting tired, and then I will continue this. Just a brief observation. So I'll just open it up for any questions if anyone has at this time. Oh, we are all happy with you.
No, but they need to say, I would say now that we have the I faced in 99,000 when my school decided to be one of to take the Bologna problem very quickly, not to be driven by the ministry. So we worked out very quickly these questions, and they had the same professors not understanding. It was really quite very complicated issue. But in my experience, it was also a very interesting occasion because we could hide very much things in this system.
If you had good.
So that the freedom of the school could be really, it was really an occasion to rebuild some kind of freedom in the school. Mm-hmm. And let's say with this written problem of master, we reached at the end, on a national level, that never is somewhere written that this has to be a written work. So that the school has much we won't do it, but in theory, you could also present a film for the school. So that this kind of solution, let's say, there were very much of this. Your story seems, yes. For me, I have lived to say.
They are very old, for example, the university people that are in this comic said, okay, fine, we understand. That can be a film, it can be an exhibition, it can be a music work. We are okay with that as a final product. But because of the procedures prior to that, so how would one judge that this film is ready for the, to be, let's say, released as a diploma? Or how one musical work would be judged as this is ready as a new work piece?
Don't you do that by committee?
Yes.
Yes, but they wanted to ask to say like so the like I said, the criteria. Well, the committee will judge.
Oh, yes. And they before, want they before. Want inside the committee's yes. brain. Yes. Like what is the number scale that you do? Say,
because for other
assessing talents. Yes. You know, yeah.
Because for other disciplines, they, for example, have the procedures like okay, the final draft is evaluated by the. The evaluating committee, they judge, and they would rather say yes, this passes and it's ready for dissertation stance, or it has to be back to the student for more improvement. So they wanted to know how, for example, the committee for sculpture tells the sculptor before his work is ready that this is okay, potentially passing, or no, you should go back from the beginning and start the sculpture. From the start. At what stage they should do this, let's say, passing procedure.
But the same question about teaching or not teaching of young teachers without any PhD degree, one of the things we reached in France, and that was a really very huge battle in the 90s, 2000, beginning of 2000, is what is was to say you cannot rank teaching criteria, but only on professional criteria, because this is a teaching that comes from the profession. Mm-hmm. Only professionals can teach, and only professional criteria can be criteria. So we brought it back on all these questions of communities. Let's say when we do a diploma, we have a professional committee. The professional committee, the criteria are professionalization. And not teaching skill. So we reach somehow going through the notion of profession to go through or not to respect this university. This is what in France at the end happened and was kind of solution. But it was the same very complex event it stays extended 2 years.
The way we do it, because I hire now in the community college system, so in my visual and performing arts, I have over 40 to 60 faculty, you know, at one time. And a lot of people come and teach for a few years and leave. So if we find someone from industry, it's a process where we gather as credentialed program-bearing faculty can assess the candidate, and then they can teach. We choose which classes they're allowed to teach based on their equivalent experience in the degree program. I mean, there's certain things they can't do. They can't be the head of the department. They can't be on certain committees. But in terms of teaching, that's just not. It's no hindrance. It's really the way we have lots of leeway to do.
Our university are also trying to find this way, but that will only be possible, for example, in the forms of several master classes or master teaching weeks, but they will never be able to be regular teaching staff. Only as an outsider, for example, Sister Joffa would never be able to be hired from the faculty or some other whoever, who is the same known artist, because there are certain entrance, it is within the university. So if you want to change it for the arts, you would have to change it for the entire university. And this is the debate now, both in the higher education law and also in the, which will then reflect also the statute. So we need this kind of discussion to be more present also in public, so that the models, different solutions, and so can be also informing the people which are now in university management to be more, let's say, creative, open-minded, flexible, in order to have more quality.
Yeah,
I think that there are two elements that could be interesting. Because I was in Istanbul now. And Dean told me exactly the same story. Mm-hmm. He had one of his best teachers in Hart that was not accredited, but it is the best, also the best player. But these criteria could not match with what it is really like. And I have the impression that maybe there are two criteria that should be looked with more attention. One is who is how works all this accreditation? Because the question is, the institutions that are accredited in all the Western countries are always independent structures, often say private, this is another question, but mainly independent. Yes, no, it's a real problem. This is a real main problem. But now the question is, they are independent, and secondly, the criteria of the criteria that are in the base are that your institution is autonomously presenting herself in an auto-evaluation. This is the criteria that is mentioned above. So, in very often it happens that the administrators of the university don't think about that these accreditation institutions are, in first place, not linked to the structure, they are independent. And secondly, that you present yourself, and it is your own presentation that is judged, and not what you do. And this is a misunderstanding, it's a very interesting misunderstanding, because it happens, I see it very often. I was very interested in this, so I participated in several committees accreditation, and I was really surprised to see that the misunderstanding does not come from the accreditation structure, but mainly from the institutions themselves, because they feel on their criteria that doesn't exist.
But the statute, which is the binding document, has to be changed. That cannot be changed before the law changes. So it is the more procedure. What I would just maybe end at the end, because and we were going to see if we are within the time or not. What we did then, we reflected in all this situation then, because I was part of the curriculum committee for doing the arts curriculum for the elementary schools. Mm-hmm. We somehow tried to correct the mistakes that were done with this fragmentizing and not interdisciplinary. And we tried to build an arts curriculum again, based on different models of improvement, Scotland, UK, Northern, Finland, and whatever. Ireland, which had very good arts curriculum in the grade 1 as well. And we fought for a system. which arts education is mandatory for the 12 years of the pre-university education. From grade 1 to 12. Actually, from preschool to grade 12, we managed to keep arts, at least the visual arts and music education, as mandatory in the core curriculum. But we also developed all these learning outcomes and the basics for other art forms like dance and drama and others that could be then also used as elective subjects, depending from the school, depending from the autonomy of the school. If they have 20% autonomy to decide, if there's an artist in the local community, they can offer, for example, drama or photograph or sculpture or whatever. And this is still not being used very well. It is in the curriculum, it is written, it is mandatory, it is within the system, but we need to work together with arts and artists, institutions and artists to inform the schools and the parents. And in music we have done it, because while music teachers are, let's say, paid only for teaching music at the collective classes within the normal curriculum, they were not, they didn't have any ways to be, let's say, organizing choir or ensemble or any other form of music performance. So they used this collective program and they presented it, and the children selected together with their parents, and they could then develop some more extracurricular activities like choir, ensemble, and other forms. But in other arts, only drama has been experienced a little bit with the experiment that Diplôme did with drama. Maybe they went to schools and worked with children and drama. Rather than that, it's not used a lot, although it is in the paper that it can be enlarged as a practice. But the whole arts curriculum pushes teachers to treat art more like integrated and to not focus on learning only art history, as it was used to be in all the theory, but to push the children to experience different mediums and use arts mainly to communicate their feelings, their messages, and to, you know, live with art, let's say, every time. Difficult in practice, more easy said than done, but we have a good basis at least in the curriculum, and we need to work a lot more on that to be a lift in practice. But I see good examples. When you go to schools, you see children drawing, using different mediums, and putting in preparing exhibitions, doing practical work also around the schoolyard. Following with the murals and things, which was not, and I think it was very common before.
Can I just say something about the UK? I mean, it's so nice to hear that in the UK now you can no longer take A level, so that's like year 12, 13, art history, unless you go to private school. Very few state schools do it, and the government wanted to withdraw it completely, but private schools objected. They've abolished even at the lower level media studies. It's no longer to be studied in English schools. Extraordinary in an age of fake news, the necessity for media literacy. This is the thing you cannot study. And there's such a big push towards what they call STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And this has real consequences, because now very few people, very, very few people are studying foreign languages. And very few people are studying English literature. So this means nobody, or very few people, now take this at university. So these become dying subjects. Or just subjects that the world we study. So we see this already in drama schools, in art schools, in music schools. The people who go there are people who come from backgrounds where they have private tuition. So it's a real change. You know, one of the things about the UK, the art school of the 60s opened up to working class people, produced a kind of pop explosion. I think there's a very different social class that now comes to be involved in those things. And at the other end, I do think it's interesting that, yeah, to teach in an art school now, people are pushed towards having PhDs. And sometimes, I mean, some of that is extraordinary work. The work I've done with Melanie Jackson around Milk and Butter, she was doing a parallel project at Reading University with Rachel Garfield. Her PhD was on milk. It was, you know, sharing some of the research base we did collectively, but it was her own project, and that fed into her art practice. And I've examined PhDs, usually of older artists who had come to some kind of block in their practice, and they just needed, and often they had found funding, and they just needed to spend 4 or 5 years reading and making, but usually writing took over from the making. And I don't know if that's because of the way that art research PhD works in the UK. Theoretically, you can produce an artwork with maybe a short critical reflective text, but at least most of the ones I saw ended up writing books.
Yeah.
And there was some art practice around it, which I think...
There's an innovative program in Portland called ISDBA. And I watched that because I've oftentimes sat and researched how can I get a PhD in student art? If I can do that, I can be the university president. You know, otherwise they won't let me. You know, and that I watched that program call itself a studio art PhD, and now it's actually they say it's a philosophy program where they admit you're coming here to write and do philosophy, but you can base it on your art practice. But you're going to be writing a lot, and you're going to end up a dissertation, so you'll be a writer.
Yes, yes, but there is an issue because of what you say. You said there is an issue that becomes really dangerous. And some years ago, I was really seriously thinking to close my research unit and to stop research and to go back. Because the Ministry of Higher Education wanted to include the research PhD with the title of PhD as something mandatory to teach in art school. Mm-hmm. And it was a huge battle that I think we won. I don't know if we win or if we won for time. This I'm not sure. But now for the moment we won. And we won only because in France there is a good ministry. Ministry of Culture. That is the only reason. Because if there would not have been in the ministry itself of the culture, people began to be convinced that yes, you have to teach, you need a degree. And so in France, it is one of the things that has very important in the last year is to say teaching art is kind of not a profession, so it was the shift. Because if not everyone wants to make, and I had very much people asking when I'm traveling, ask me, could I come to France to have a time? Because you know, I need a PhD to teach. Yeah. If you want to make research with me, you know, it takes 10 years now. Don't come. It's not good for teaching. Don't come. But the danger that this kind of title is coming doesn't allow to a good artist to teach. It's one of the biggest problems that we have all over the world. It's not only here. Mm-hmm. It is really an enormous danger. In some countries in Europe, this system has brought to art school where there are no more active artists.
Mm-hmm. Or researchers.
Yeah, because the art So at the moment in the ministry, they understood that if they make this, all the professionals would not be anymore in the schools. So they understood this, but because of the Ministry of Culture. So it's a very dangerous issue, I think. But even in British school, the teaching art and arts has become so much work.
It has become really crazy
how much in Britain an artist has to work in the school.
And also, I mean, I think because the art schools are often part of the university, so they've put themselves forward for this research excellence frameworks, which is measuring outputs. So the artist has to have outputs, that pushes them towards making publications, because it's very hard to, maybe an exhibition counts, but you have to collect so much documentation.
It works so much to collect.
Yes, and part of the joy is collecting documents. The other part is so much
so much
work with the students, because the student numbers are so high, and you're doing crits,
thanks for sticking
it out. Everyone agrees.
It would be interesting then to hear the students, but obviously that we should have a panel of art students thinking what art institutions offers.
Why do we suck?
Just to add something, not maybe only in this context, but if you think, would you rather have bad artists teaching art? Or artists that are not good artists but have PhDs. So because you have also this option, you have very bad artists becoming teachers. Bad, I mean, it's a word.
Yes.
Everyone has a question, but those who really don't have a practice, and they end up being the teachers without a PhD, but also without a practice. So to me, this is the terrible situation that
I have a very good example in school. There was a teacher saying to all the students, you have to do minimum 10 drawings a day. And then one day I asked him, but do you do 10 drawings
a day?
Has the individual say, I think that's maybe
Jenny Gracie, for example, because I have been a member of the committee judging the applications, and for example, in two or three occasions asked the staff who were in these committees, we are facing court law, court processes against us. Because the instruments of measuring have been, let's say, so technical and so on, they don't allow this professional evaluation. So if I, for example, had two candidates, and we were three of us in the team, and we judged with our best, a good intention that, let's say, similar values, similar age, similar number of productions, but we feel and we know because of the artworks that we have seen, let's say, by this person, that this might be a better person suiting the job. And then the other complaint, that there are procedures that we can be in processes of courts. And this is crazy because you can be, if you, for example, falsify or hidden evidence that could increase his points. But for being judged why you liked this, let's say, personality more than the others, I am potentially going to be two such processes. I'm really looking forward if I am there in order to see what you want to judge.
And what if they fail at their civil suit, don't they have to pay the cost of the
No, it happens not everywhere. This is like in Italy, exactly the same system, that you have a national kind of criteria of rules you have to fulfill. You cannot get a teacher in Italy, in a university, without a process. You have always a process.
Numbered process.
In Italy, the process takes 10 years. So the problem is not who will pay because the process will never end. But in any way, they get to this kind of process because it's a national criterion. In France, the difference is that my school, my direction, with us teachers, produces a committee and chooses. So you have. So the first thing they did in France when we went to all this problem of the Bologna agreement was to build autonomous structures that are structures of cultural and educational collaboration. So that the school is, when it is big enough, it is autonomous. And sometimes they treat the school together.
We went the opposite. We had those concepts.
And now you are facing it.
Everything was done with the idea that now we have stayed.
But this is also the Italian story. This is the story of the 19th century in Italy. Italy is a very young country.
Unless you
nationalize
the world. The Balkans doesn't end at the Adriatic, actually. It stands to the boot. That's how I